I'm Jennifer Moorhatch. I'm one of the choral editors here at J.W. Pepper and part of the team that cultivates the music that we hope that you want to buy and that you want to listen to and that you want to perform with your groups. We had the chance to meet up with Jamey Ray and Derric Johnson. Both are founding members and arrangers for the groups Voices of Liberty and Voctave, which, if you're not aware, are two of the most well-known and popular a cappella groups out there performing today. We went in depth with both of these amazing composers to find out what inspired them to start their own groups, a little about their writing techniques, as well as some helpful tips for choirs performing their music. There is a lot of great information shared here, and all of the selections we go over today can be found in the links below or at jwpepper.com. Now, let's get right into the interview.
My name is Jamey Ray. I am the choral editor for Excelsior Music Publishing, and it is an understatement to say that it is an honor to get to introduce Derric Johnson.
Well, thank you, Jamey Ray, and that would be me.
Yes.
Thank you.
Let's hear a little bit about your background, who you are, and what people might recognize you for, just right off the cuff.
My job that I teach is at Rollins College. I'm a professor at Rollins, and I get to work with different groups there, and I teach music technology classes, and it's a great fun thing for me to do. But I also have a group called Voctave, and we have been recording and traveling for about 7 years now. And interestingly enough, the group has been heavily influenced by another group that I was a part of and that everybody in the group was a part of, and that's Voices of Liberty, which kind of brings us to where everything is today for this. Derric created Voices of Liberty. I'll let him tell more about that, but it's something that has literally influenced thousands of singers over the last 40 plus years. And so what I'm trying to do is get as much of that music out for people to be able to enjoy it the way that we all have for that many years.
And I'd say that one of the great times in life is when you get to look over your shoulder and find young people like Jamey Ray, who really started out with us, first of all as a fan when he's a young boy, then he came into Voices of Liberty and sang there and influenced the group greatly there, and now he's off doing Voctave, and it's a thrill. I think that when you get to an age where there's more leaves on the ground than there are on the trees, the question becomes not what do you do, it's what do you help others do. Now, the first part of life is all about what you do. And then I think as you move on is how do you help other people fulfill their dreams and move to their opportunity. So I'm just so thrilled to sit here next to Jamey Ray, who I count as a great friend through all these years. And you're lucky to have his music as well as mine. So,
well, thank you.
I mean, from my heart, I mean that sincerely.
Well, thank you for that.
That's great. Well, I think people are going to be really interested to hear the background behind some of your arrangements, Derric, and maybe how they came to publication. But really, who were they for?
There's a backstory to everything, of course. And Jamey knows this about me. If it doesn't have a story, I don't care about it. It's all about stories. So it really began, Voices of Liberty began, with another group called Regeneration, which is kind of a traveling show choir, gospel show choir. We're doing 500 shows a year, which is 11 every week. So we work really hard, traveled 100,000 miles, sang to a million people every year. Disney discovered us. A man named Bob Cross was the entertainment director for the Magic Kingdom in 1972 when Disney first opened. And he heard Regeneration singing at a Rotary luncheon in Winter Garden, Florida, which is about a mile and a half from where we are sitting right now. He heard the group, left his card with my business manager, and said, when this is done, have Derric call me right away. So I called and he said, man, you guys are more Disney than Disney. Love your sound, love your look, you've got the whole thing. Want to hire you to come in, your group, for 11 days, do 4 shows a day in front of the castle. Because we're trying, as entertainment, to get a stage in front of the castle. There was no stage there when Magic Kingdom opened. And he said, we need a stage there. operation says, who'd ever want to see a show in front of Cinderella's Castle? And we say, only everybody. So we'll bring you in for 11 days, four shows a day. That's 44. We'll take audience response. We'll do the surveys and see if people like it or not. Well, the shows were incredibly well received. We had people line up all the way up Main Street to the train station. We had these Voice of God speakers on steroids. I mean, they were huge. And they shoved that sound. It was amazing. So they built the stage. We came back for five more years as Regeneration do the patriotic program. Then they put Kids of the Kingdom together, and I didn't want to stay and be that at that time. They offered that, and I said, thank you. We have another mission in mind. So they put together their group, and so we were done. And we all said a sad goodbye. And then we had produced Regeneration, an a cappella Christmas album that
I have them.
Was really quite astounding to the world. In fact, I was up in New York. I was going to do some writing for Radio City Music Hall. And I was in a meeting with Bob Yanni, who was the president and creative director for Radio City. He's the one to call me up there to do some writing. And this guy named Don, I didn't know who Don was. I never was into Broadway. That wasn't my, I was living out in California. We never had Broadway. So the phone rang, Bob Yanni, in charge of the meeting, said, I've got to go, I'll be back at 2:30. Don, take Derric to lunch. So Don and I go to lunch, and I ask, so what do you do besides music director for Radio City? Because that would not be necessarily full-time. He said, I do some writing for Broadway. And I said, oh, really? Anything I might know? He said, well, I've been nominated for 13 Tonys. I said, what? His name is Don Pippin, who, of course, is this giant. And I'm having lunch with this guy. I didn't know who he was. He said, I have one question for you. I said, okay. He said, how did you record Do You Hear What I Hear? I said, what? I mean, we're this little kind of gospel show group. You know, I mean, are you kidding? He said, everybody has that album up here, and they all talk about it. Nobody can figure out it's a double choir arrangement. How did you, if you'll tell me your secret, I can tell everybody and I'll be a hero here. I'm thinking, this is crazy. But I explained how we got it done, and he was thrilled with that and went on to, you know, tell his friends, I guess. But that album hit both in New York and also then out in California. I mean, nobody had ever heard any a cappella sound like that. It was fresh and nice and had high sopranos and low basses and smoky altos and heroic baritones, but they put together a great line sound. Anyway, so then Disney called. We had already finished our patriotic stuff for them. They said, can you do that Christmas things? Can you do that live, a cappella? I said, sure, of course. They said, well, then come be Disney carolers for us for the month of December. And we'll do a living nativity scene. You do 4 hours in the Magic Kingdom over the villages, which now is Disney Springs, and we'll do three living nativity scenes. And they can sing there and you can narrate. So I said, fine. So that's where that all started. So we went every Christmas then to do that, and it was wonderful. Then when Epcot opened, and I was looking for something really else to do in March, of 1982, they called it, we're thinking about an a cappella group in the American Adventure called Voices of Liberty. Would you be interested in doing that? I said, I'd love to do that. So then we moved in as basically kind of Regeneration grown up, you know, because now you can live at home, have babies, get married, I mean, all that good kind of stuff that normal people do. So that was there. I think what made the sound significant, what I tried to do, instead of build the sound from the bottom up, which is band, you always start at the bottom. I wanted to start with a sound at the top and match that sound. So first sopranos, they're going to be our lead. Second sopranos have to sound like the first soprano. And I had a little exercise. I worked out a real simple little thing on an E-flat. Then the altos have to sound like the person above. The tenor has to sound like the first tenor sounds like the low alto. In other words, that E-flat is going to be kind of low for an alto. But it's up here for a tenor. Well, he can't sing it like that. He's got to sing it the way she does. And then all the way down. So that's what gives it kind of that velvet that velvet sound, a blend that became really different sound-wise to everybody. I mean, it was no big deal to me. That's what I always did and wanted, but it just kind of caught on. So that's, and then Voices went on for, well, it was still going on for 40-some years now. So yeah. It's been great.
That's so awesome. And as a first soprano here, I'm kind of digging the whole your whole philosophy about how you build
you
the choral sound.
Sopranos rule.
Yes.
That's it.
Amen to that.
I got you, Jennifer. You're wonderful.
Well, you know, it's funny because my first time hearing the Voices of Liberty was when I was on, I think I was visiting Disney as a college student for the first time. And we were there on tour with our college chorale. So, of course, I was there with all my singing buddies. And we had no idea where we were going or what we were doing. And we literally kind of like stumbled into the American Pavilion. And it was like time stopped. Like, what is this? And I'm not moving till they're done. And I just remember, especially the soprano lines, I'm just in awe, you know, of that. And it's just reverberating everywhere and hearing these glorious harmonies and thinking, what is this all about? And I have to come back and see it again. And, you know, at that time, I didn't know that there were recordings or, you know, anything else that you could do from that. It was just like a Disney experience for me, but it was really amazing. Still remember it.
Well, and I mean, I'm happy to talk about how I discovered Derric and his music. My mother sang in a group at church when I was younger, and she had these books and these cassette tapes, for those of you who remember what cassette tapes are, of Regeneration. And there was one particular tape. It was Hymns in Velvet, and the last song on the tape was It Is Well With My Soul. And the soloist on that was just, I couldn't get enough of the arrangement. I couldn't get enough of the sound of her voice. And I was in elementary school, and I had a tape player. She loves it when I tell this story. But I had a tape player in my bed, and I would rewind. I knew how long to hold rewind to get back to the beginning of the song until I wore out the tape. And fast forward many years to where I'm in college, and I was singing at a church here in Orlando, and this person walks up on stage to sing a song with the choir. And I asked the person next to me, I say, who is that? Who is that person? Like, that's Tiffany Coburn. How do you not know who Tiffany Coburn is? So I run and I get her album in the lobby, and it has that It Is Well With My Soul on it. And then my worlds collided, and I thought, okay, what does she do? Where is this music? And they're like, she sings with Voices of Liberty. Go listen to Voices of Liberty. And I mean, I had heard Voices at that point, but it was only through Candlelight, really. And then Derric's lovely wife, Debbie, can attest to the fact that I used to come and sit on the floor in front of the group with a video camera and just watch and listen to everything that they did. I wanted to study the sound. I bought so many of Derric's charts that he would mail to me, the physical copies, and I would go through and I literally would put them in notation just so that I could see every single line. I was that big nerd. And so then getting to come in and actually sing his music the very first day in rehearsal for me was a big day, getting to sing with these people that I've idolized for so many years. And now what's interesting is Tiffany sings with Voctave, and I've gotten to write things for her as well. And I'm certainly benefiting from what the sound that Derric created. And Voctave has developed its own sound, but it really started with, the weeks, months, years of rehearsal and technique and style training that happen at Voices of Liberty is something that Voctave has benefited from, because it's easy to find a home base. It's easy. We still use the soprano down mentality because the first thing people hear when they are listening to you is your sopranos. And if they're having to find another person to match to, it might not work. So I've stolen that from Derric. I know a lot of people have... I'm going to say I've borrowed that from Derric. I've borrowed it from Derric, as have a lot of other people. But that's definitely my background with learning and discovering Derric's music and Voices of Liberty. And it really all came back to Tiffany and Regeneration before I even know what any of these things were.
That's awesome. Well, let's kind of shift gears and talk a little bit more about the Candlelight Concerts, the Christmas arrangements. As we're kind of heading into that time of year, maybe some people might be looking at some of those new arrangements that we have. Well, they're not new, but new to us, new to all of us in publication. And talk a little bit about maybe how they came to be in the candlelight services, just that whole vibe of what was going on there.
Well, I mean, you want to talk about the history of just Candlelight briefly. And I mean, the ones that we have that are going to be in that show is going to be probably Joy to the World. Mm-hmm. We're currently working on next year's catalog and have some more Christmas things of Derric, which are my favorites of Derric's, the Christmas. So there's going to be more of them in the future. But the Derric can speak best to kind of how Candlelight started and these songs came in. He was telling me a little about it earlier, so.
Well, Candlelight is a whole different bird than singing in the American Adventure. Because it's not a cappella.
Right.
It is orchestrated. And it's with a big choir with voices in front, to guide and help. They're on mics in case the choir needs help. But it's quite a thing. It's the Candlelight concept, I'll do it as briefly as I can, began back in the 1960s when Walt Disney was given the job to do entertainment for the opening sessions for the Winter Olympics, which were in Squaw Valley. Is where it was, uh-huh. And Walt was up there to do the entertainment, and Dr. Hurt, Charles Hurt from USC, was there to handle a big choir, a couple thousand voice choir for this big opening. They had never met before. They knew each other, of course, but never met. Well, the day of opening rehearsal, the run-through, it was a blizzard, and so you couldn't do anything. So there, Dr. Hurt and Walt Disney are sitting together in the lobby of this big brand new hotel, fire going and all. And Charles Hurt asked Walt, among other things, how are things going at your new theme park? And Walt Disney said, well, it's going great. And Charles said, you miss anything? He said, yeah, I miss Christmas carolers. And so Dr. Hurt said, I can do that for you. I'll get 500 or 600 singers together and we'll come. Walt said, fine, I'll be in my office. My quarters above the hall, city hall. And I'll open my window and you can sing for me. So they did, and did that. But Dr. Hurt stood in the middle, up in the square there, by the railroad station, with the choir surrounding him. So the guests couldn't see anything except backs of singers. Very unsatisfactory. Dr. Hurt said, why don't we put risers up at the train station and then the choir can sing out to the people and you can still hear just as well from where you are. So then Candlelight was born in California, two nights, a Saturday and a Sunday, but 1,000 voices in East. And when Magic Kingdom opened, the first show they brought from California was Candlelight because it opened in October. And so Christmas was the first time they could mount it up. So Dr. Hurt would fly. He'd do two in California and come the next weekend to do Saturday, Sunday in Orlando. Mm. And then he was getting older, and so the trip was hard. So they began to look for other directors. After a couple of years, they settled on me. He said, you want to give it a try? I said, man, I'd love to. 1,000 voice choir and full orchestra and Herald trumpets up on top of the train station. I mean, it's amazing. So I said, sure. So we started. Then they were just using music off the shelf that anybody could buy. Too long a story to get into, but I had shared one of the things I had written for orchestra and all for regeneration at a Christmas program. And the guy was a Disney exec. He said, man, we got to use it for Candlelight. And he called somebody over. I know who it was. Said, be sure you get this music from Derric Candlelight this year. So that was my first arrangement to offer to Candlelight. And then they decided they really needed to do that show with original music, not just stuff that anybody could buy any place. So that's what I started to arrange for that. And we'd add two songs every year until we got it going. But Joy to the World is one that works a cappella, to me even better. That God only created one instrument. And that's the voice. So I'll always defer to voice. So Joy to the World is virtually the same arrangement, just without the orchestra. And that's available now.
Do you remember when it came into the show? Do you remember when Joy to the World started at Candlelight?
No, not really. It was in the 90s, though.
In the 90s?
Yeah.
So it's been around for... Well, I sang it in high school.
Yeah.
And I so badly wanted to be soprano or alto so I could do one of those, the bell things. They're the best part. And alto 2 has the best line. And I know that Debbie knows that too. But alto 2 has the best line in that, in the bell parts. That's good.
Yeah, it's very festive as an a cappella piece. It really, it gets on you and has that whole bell section where the girls are doing it in four chimes. And your kids, your singers, we'll have to work on it a bit because of the timing, but I promise you it's worth it. Once they get it, they will always want to do it. I was, in parentheses, I taught at a university in Oregon for 6 years, and we had a reunion not long ago, our 20th reunion, and we had a program. I said, okay, what songs do you guys want to sing? I'm not going to, your choir, I'm just coming, I'll be a guest conductor for you guys. Well, we put it together, and the song they wanted the most and we ended with was Joy to the World. And that was in February. They don't care. They didn't care what the date was. They just want to sing Joy to the World. So it has that kind of emotion for your singers. It's the kind of thing that they just want to sing again and again.
It's one of those that as a singer, it's rewarding to sing. Not every song feels rewarding to sing as a singer. And as an audience member, it's rewarding to hear. So those both those check boxes are important. But what we were just actually talking about before we started this, that one of Derric's, all of Derric's arrangements are wonderful, but my favorites are the Christmas ones. And some of the other Christmas ones that we've got are the Away in a Manger. And even his, I'm going to ask him to tell the story about French Chorale of Praise in a second. But these songs, they, as weird as it sounds, they sound like Christmas. I mean, there's millions probably of Christmas songs out there, but there's a specific sound. It's a nostalgic sound, this Christmas sound, and that's where these pieces are. Away in a Manger absolutely gives that one for me, as well as Still, 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 which is a beautiful, beautiful one of his. But French Chorale of Praise. Most people don't even know what that title is. People look at it and they're like, well, it's going to be in French. There is a verse in French. It's not tough, but what is the background on that one?
Well, I was minister of music in the church out in San Diego, had a really fine youth choir. They could sing pretty much what I could write. And they had, going to high school, big high school, and a fine choir. And so, of course, as kids will do, being so loyal, they said to the director, their high school director, why don't you use some of Derric's arrangements sometime? And he said, because he does not write real music. So my kids came and told me that. You don't write real music. I said, well, I got to prove to him that they didn't care. They loved what they did. So I wrote this thing called French Chorale of Praise that's very multi-parts moving it out. Again, it's
one. Contrapuntal.
Very contrapuntal. There you go. In four parts. And it'll take a little while to learn it. But it's in one of those, again, people sing it, after they finish singing it, they smile.
Yeah.
I mean, you just feel good about it. And it does have a French verse in it that you can use in French, or you can, it's English, just do the same.
Yeah.
It's one verse. Anyway, so, but it's one of those things that just is fun to do.
And we've got also, the Hanukkah medley. Hanukkah medley, interestingly enough, with the exception of the high D at the end, which is one of the most glorious moments there, the rest of it is very singable.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, it's all very much in the rain. Do you remember where that one came from?
Yeah. There was a big Christmas show. Carol Lawrence came to do a Christmas spectacular. Oh. And we had the Montavani strings and all sorts of stuff. And I was in charge of all the vocal music. They had this you know package for the Israeli contingency. They said, we got to have something of Hanukkah. And I said, okay, but I don't know how to, I love the song,
sure.
But it's a song. Mm-hmm. I mean, what are you going to do versions of Hanukkah? I mean, why would I do, I mean, I didn't. So I said, how about if we add Gradle, 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 and then it was a wonderful Israeli song that I picked up from our bus driver. I was in a tour of Israel one time called Evenu Shalom Elechem, which means we bring God's peace to you. I mean, it's the perfect for Christmas. So it's three songs of that wonderful Israeli heritage that are recognizable to anyone of that faith. I mean, you sing that song, mm-hmm. and there's immediate physical response from people in the audience, you know. Well, you got to me, which is important as we put programs together.
Well, it's nice because, again, as a singer, I've sung that one a million times, and I could sing that and never be bothered by it. I love singing that one. It's just, it's fun because, I mean, a lot of people, like he said, you'll know the songs, you'll recognize the songs, but the way that he's set them, they're fun to sing, which is great.
Yeah, it's awesome. I'm loving this talking about the music. Jamey, help me out. Can we talk a little bit more about Away in the Manger and Still, Still, Still? And is there anything I'm missing?
Where did the Away in the Manger come from?
Came out of a Christmas cantata program that I was doing at my church long ago. I had a great music program there, so I wrote a lot of stuff that we just adapted here with all the cascading voices, and it's got some very lovely moments in it.
It's what I like about it is it's not difficult. The parts are not difficult to learn. I mean, French Chorale of Praise is going to take some time just because it's fast and there's a lot of notes, but Away in a Manger is exactly what Away in a Manger should be, which I think is why people love it. It's, I don't want to use the word simple because it's not that it's simple. It's moving, but it's not, the notes aren't difficult. He didn't come up with some crazy extravagant arrangement that no one's expecting. It's just exactly what you want to hear. It's delicate. And as a singer, again, it's very pleasing to sing. I'll probably say that about all of them. I love singing all of them. But Away in a Manger is one that is what I like for it. And I'm sure that, I mean, programming is important. You know programming just about better than anybody. But it's the moment for a Christmas show for an audience to...
Just sit back and relax.
Yes.
Yeah, and don't wake up the baby.
Don't wake the baby.
That would be the key to that song. Don't wake up the baby.
Which is, I mean, similar, honestly, even Still, Still, Still. I had not heard Still, Still, Still until the Christmas in Velvet 5, mm-hmm. I think that you did. Did you write it for that album? Or was it before that?
I had written that for a Christmas Tree show at First Baptist.
Years before.
Long ago.
Because that one mixes with the Angels We Have Heard on High,
right.
The Gloria in the middle, which I love how he's... The treatment has got hush, because it's all about, again, don't wake the baby. And there's this hush, hush. And what was nice is the singers that I bring in to record all this music for the demos that you listen to are all singers who have sung these things for years. And as we pull out the next title, they were just more excited to sing these songs. And that one was one that they had not sung a lot. But it's by the end of the day, they were like, this is now a new favorite. So it's fun to just get to hear some new to us type pieces, because Voices doesn't sing that one, but that's been around for a while then, I guess. Mm-hmm. But I absolutely love that one.
And I love your sentiment there, don't wake the baby. I think I've been to the Candlelight concerts, I think 4 times, and we started coming down when my kids were really small. And I was going to hesitate to say this, but I'll say it. Yeah, that worked. Don't wake the baby. Mm-hmm. A whole day in the Disney parks and then sitting down and hearing beautiful music. And I'm like, what? You can't. This is awesome music. You got to, you know. And now they appreciate it so much more. Both my kids are musicians and it's just great. But I do remember that when they were little, and it was just an amazing experience. So thank you so much. One other thing I wanted to ask you is, how many singers have been part of Voices of Liberty over the years, and where did you find them?
Well, through the years, we had a reunion. Was it last August, I think?
June. I think it was in June.
Anyway, we had 200 back, so there's been, I never kept track of them like that, but there are hundreds who sang in Voices. Interestingly, there are thousands who said they did. when we first started Voices of Liberty, we had 16 in the first cast, then they doubled the cast. It's because we need to do more shows, so we had 32. And we were auditioning 1,000 people about every year, but then your need becomes less and less for numbers because a lot of people stay around. Like my wife Debbie, for instance, who sang in Voices of Liberty for a span of 33 years, 47,000 shows, which is nobody's ever going to touch that.
Nope.
You know, I mean, that's a record that will stand because, but there are people who stayed that long. We had a number of people stay 20 years you know. Mm-hmm. And so it's hard to keep track of how many. It wasn't like we had a new cast every year.
Sure.
And that was really the fun of Voices, because we would keep a whole bunch, maybe add two or three would go. Sometimes they had other things to do. Sometimes we needed to help them find something else to do, you know. And what we're after, when we're talking about this earlier today, my thing always was, I'm looking for really nice people who happen to sing very well. Because I can teach people how to sing what I want, if they're given our singers, how I want, but I can't teach them nice. They're going to get nice a long time before they get to me. And because we spend so much time together, we'd sing for 15 minutes and there's a 30-minute break. And then 15 minutes again, and you do that all day. Well, that 30 minutes in between is really important.
Yep.
And so sometimes people just didn't fit into that mold, of what you're trying to build this group to be, which to me always is going to be a family. We care about each other. We celebrate people's birthdays. When they're in trouble, we care for them. But I mean, that's the kind of people I want to work with. And they've got to sing very well. But I don't start with the singing. I'm going to start with their eyes. Is there anybody home in there? And then are they nice? How do they act, even in their audition? You know, so that I would say close to 1,000 people have been in Voices of Liberty.
At that point, you obviously started auditions in Orlando. Did you ever go to other cities and audition?
Oh, yeah, we traveled all over the place looking for them, yeah. A number of times. I often felt we didn't get to the right cities. The guys would always want to go to New York because they got to see shows at night.
Sure.
Except the singers I'm looking for are not Broadway builders. You know, they're more cultured. Yeah. I'm nothing wrong with that. That's wonderful, but that's not the style that we do.
More choral.
But yeah, very much more choral. Mm-hmm. So I had some spots that I would go. I was auditioning all the time, any place I went, and I was doing a lot of stuff. So I'd find voices and remember who they were. And so when one girl leaves suddenly because her husband got transferred, well, you've got to find another first soprano. Well, you better have one in your pocket.
Right.
You know, to know what's going on. So that's how a lot of it happened.
So have there been any notable alums of Voices of Liberty that have gone on to do anything exciting that we might know about?
Well, yeah. I mean, great Scott. How do we say? Tiffany Coburn, of course, mm-hmm. being a star, you know, to do wonderful. Kevin Miles, who sang bass for us in Voices for about 20 years. Then he went to Dapper Dan's, became a barbershop singer, was an international contest winner in the barbershop. I mean, so the list can go, I think, on and on. I guess, you know, I've never got, it's nice when great things happen to your people. Well, Jamey Ray, being certainly, look at, here's a guy that's doing great stuff today. And he came out of our system, you know.
Well, I mean, there's people that within the Voices world are famous to us because they've set the bar. I mean, he's mentioned Debbie, and Debbie is absolutely an alto that every single alto that's ever been in Voices of Liberty wants to sound like. She's an iconic sound for the group, just like Tiffany is an iconic sound for the sopranos. I mean, I remember the very first time I did a gig with Brian Harden. I was actually driving him to the gig, and he's in the car with me, and he said, let's practice some things. He was a baritone, and he started singing, and I stopped him. I said, you're the sound. The albums, the recordings that I listened to when I was younger, yes. It's your sound. You're all over this. And so it's just interesting to get to meet and be influenced by these icons in the Voices world. And because, I mean, we first talked about Derric developing this sound and what it is. It's the people around him that have created this. And it changes by people who are in it. But there's always people that kind of it comes back to, that was the right sound. That was it. And so those people are big deals to the singers that have ever been in or around the group before, in my opinion.
Either Jamey or Derric, what kinds of groups do you think should be looking at these arrangements now, and do you have any advice for them as they prepare them?
Yeah. First of all, again, have nice people as much as possible. Your singers, for the things, a lot of things that I write, they're pretty extreme ranges, but I've found, you know, people, I have all these coloraturas in my life, mm-hmm. you know. In fact, we had a regeneration reunion not too long ago. So I gathered all the first sopranos for a picture with me in the middle. I said, "You're the people that made me famous," because that's where that sound began. I never had trouble finding high sopranos. Usually there are girls there, they don't know they can do it because nobody ever asked them to do it before. So in my church, I mean, I had a high school choir. I always had a high E-flat soprano. Mm-hmm. I always had a low E-flat bass in high school. And same thing with college. And I mean, just they're there. I remember one girl called me one time. I was looking for a soprano in Regen. Her name was Janice. And she's incredibly great. But she called and said, "Now you're looking for a soprano." I said, "I am." I said, "I'm looking for a first soprano." She said, "I'm a first soprano." I said, "Well, to me, a first soprano is pretty different than most guys would do." I said, "How high do you sing?" She said, "I don't know. How high do you write?" Oh, man. I said, "Come up here to Montgomery." I live in the time. "Come and audition for me. I just love that attitude. Isn't that great?" And I mean, she's incredible. That E-flat to this day, I mean, that's home for her. Mm. And she had never, she's a vocal performance major.
Yeah.
From a major university in the South, but nobody ever had her sing like that. But she was wonderful, you know. So there's people like that all around.
Well, and what's nice is that a lot of people hear a Voices of Liberty arrangement and they think, oh, it's all about the high notes and it's all about low notes, and their group can't sing it because of that. If you look at the actual arrangements, what's nice for Derric's music is that, first of all, the voice leading makes it so singable. But I mean, even just the ones that we've talked about, Joy to the World, there's a B flat at the end of it, but the rest of the song, the highest note for this. Yeah, there's, which is fine. I mean, the high schools have B flats in them, but the highest note other than that, and you only want probably one person on that anyway. You don't want 50 sopranos up there. The rest of it is an F, maybe the top note. Same thing for the tenors. I mean, I picked the pieces of Derric. There are some of Derric's that are terrifying if you're a soprano or a tenor, or if you're going to be singing low for alto and bass. And those will be there too, I think, for sure. But and there are choirs that can do those as well. I mean, there are choirs out there with, they've got 75 people in the choir and they've got 8 sopranos that can sing above a high C. Well, great. So then you're going to go get some of the more complicated things. But this first round of pieces that I picked specifically because they're very accessible. I mean, even a normal high school group that has all 4 parts, honestly, Simple Gifts and Shenandoah both are pieces that just about any high school choir could do. It doesn't break into 15, 20 parts. It lives in that 6 to 8 part world that even having a couple of people on that part, it works. So it's very accessible. Even, honestly, I think my middle school choir could have done your Simple Gifts. I had basses in my middle school choir that could sing F and E flat, which to me now is kind of crazy to think about. But I'm purposefully picking things from the beginning to be accessible, because what I would love is for, I would love a majority of choirs to be able to be exposed to it and fall in love with his music. I mean, most of them have already gotten to hear it, but what I love about Derric's music and what I've tried to borrow is that I want the piece to be fun to sing. I want it to sound harder than it is and not have the audience be able to predict what's happening. And that's what I have always loved about Derric's music, is that you hear these things. And what's special about it is it's the singers. It's not that it's the crazy hardest parts. It's the style that he's created and the chords that he's got in there. And that's what makes it singable. As opposed to some of these other, I mean, there's choral pieces out there right now that are 12, 13, 14 parts, double choir, that are crazy hard to sing, and you've got to have X amount of people to be able to do it. That's not what these are, which is nice. It's nice to, you could do this with an ensemble of 10, 12 people. Or you could do it with a choir of 100, which is kind of fun to get to see those things done too. But I mean, I think that they're definitely accessible, especially this first round of pieces. I picked them specifically because I wanted as many high school community choirs, church choirs, even some maybe advanced middle school choirs to be able to look at some of these pieces in the catalog. And I think that it'd be easy for a lot of people. Well, not easy. It would be accessible for a lot of people.
And the style itself If somebody's never heard one of these arrangements, how would you describe it to them?
I mean, the description that you've used forever, I love, the pop choral.
Yeah.
I mean, it's definitely a choral approach to everything. The main difference is the vowels. And I mean, the sound production doesn't change. I mean, people hear Voices of Liberty and they get scared because they think, oh, straight tone everything and it's not healthy for your voice. It's not about straight tone. It's about knowing when to use vibrato. That's the biggest thing with his music, I believe. Mm-hmm. But, I mean, I don't know. Beyond that, what would you...
No, the basic concept is vowels first. So I even did a warm-up for vowels. Mm-hmm. But we don't... I never use the stretching kind of... Because I think you need to come ready to go. Otherwise, you're like a carpenter who shows up and says, okay, where's the hammer? Well, you bring your hammer. Come on, we're going to give you nails and wood. So if you're a singer, you come warmed up. That's your hammer. So then what we're going to do is tune up your vowels so that we agree on that. Mm. And, of course, in voices, it's hard in one sense because you don't have the same cast every day. It shuffles all the way through. That's different. What we do than what Voctave does, because mm-hmm. they have the same people all the time. Mm-hmm. Although I found out, even though you might get the same 8 people, they're not the same people, because the girl's really excited. You see, we're going out to dinner. I think he's going to propose. And he broke up. So the next day, she comes. She's not the same alto that she was the day before. You know. So what you've got to do is find that common ground, which will be vowels. And so I do this little exercise that my group, my choir, I have a community choir now that's great. And we do that to start always. That's where you go. So vowels bring beauty. Consonants bring passion. Mm-hmm. And so you got to work on, like, there's a big difference between that was amazing or that was amazing. It's not about volume, really. I did a clinic not too long ago, and I asked this high school soprano to step out, and I said, you have a boyfriend? She said, of course. And she looked like she would have a boyfriend, you know, okay. Beautiful girl. I said, okay, you're going to the prom, and you're coming down. The guy's already in. He's got his corsage. Your mom has let him in. And you're coming down the steps, and you're dressed in your prom dress. Would you rather have him say, you look wonderful, or you look wonderful? She said, I'll take wonderful. I said, thank you very much. So passion comes in the consonant. So that we work both of those really hard, as well as the progressions and all the rest. But you got to start someplace, and foundation will be vowels, and then passion and consonants.
So I think it's not just pop, though. I mean, there is a lot of jazz influence in your writing as well.
Oh, for sure. I think the style that by saying pop choral, is that it's not about the style isn't pop. The style is still choral. The influence of how to pronounce things is more on the pop side. And the biggest question that there, and obviously there's always exceptions to everything. I mean, a soprano is not going to sing a high C the same way that the alto is going to sing a C an octave below her. So there's going to be some adjustments, sure. But the biggest question is, well, how do I pronounce this? Okay, well, say it. How would you say it?
Sing it the way you say it.
You sing it the way you say it.
So to me, pop choral, pop is not a musical style. Pop is off the Latin for populace, for people. So it's people choral. So we are trying to get to, I want you to understand what we're singing. For instance, in Joy to the World, we have that horrendous word, N-A-T-U-R-E, nature. I mean, and every choir director in the world has a different approach to that sound. I mean, I've had people coming in, and we had that with Candlelight all the time, because these teachers, one said, not your. That was how she taught her students to sing. Let heaven and not your sing. Not, what's that? I mean, that's terrible. I mean, yet this farm couple coming in from Iowa, never been more than 60 miles away from home. And for their 25th anniversary, their kids gave a trip to Disney. And so they're sitting, listening to Voices of Liberty, and they sing, let heaven and not your sing. And I can see Sarah leans over and hits Amel and say, what's a nodier? He says, I don't know, but don't it sound pretty? See, that doesn't work for me. So my thing always has been, sing it the way you say it. It's people choral, if that makes sense to you. That's how I would define that. Yeah. So with my choir now, we'll stop every, I mean, probably every third or fourth rehearsal, say, okay, just say the word for me. How do you say that? Well, everybody says nature. Mm-hmm. So we're going to sing nature. Well, boy, I mean, you're legit choral people. They go crazy over that. But I'm after the audience. I'm after the people. Mm-hmm. I want them to understand that word. So that's where our philosophy. So we're way off center in a lot of ways, except we know why we're there, which pulls us back pretty much towards center, you know.
Yeah,
I love that. Actually, you led me to the next question, which I wanted to ask you, Derric. What's your dream? What's your legacy dream for, you know, how you would want to see your music live on forever?
Well, I this is an incredible start here with, you know, J.W. Pepper. My goodness, what an opportunity there. I'm still writing, still getting things happening. I'm writing a book right now called What's Your Encore? Meaning if you're not dead, God's not done. So what's your next? Dreams come like seasons to me. We love spring. Oh, it's great. It is going to give way to summer. You can't stop it. And winter will give way to spring. And I mean, so dreams can have an end. Nothing wrong with it. Just it's time to do something else. So what would you do if you knew you couldn't fail? I mean, that's the next step out there. I think for all of us, if we're still alive, you got to be doing something besides sitting on the couch and watching old TV movies. I mean, I don't want to do that.
I mean, it's interesting, and I mean, I'll say this for Derric, just this last month, there was a big celebration for his 90th birthday. And I mean, I used to say to people, I'm like, I don't even know if I want to make it to 90. But all I can think is, if I'm doing what Derric's doing, I want to make it to 90. Because he's constantly doing things. And I mean, just for the legacy, I'm trying to be this much of a piece by going in and getting these pieces out there. And I got to say that I feel like a kid in a candy store each year going and saying, ooh, I want this song, and I want this song, and I want this song. And I feel like I would want to put out 50 songs a year if I had the opportunity. It's great for me because there are a lot of people who know Voices of Liberty. There are a lot of people who have heard Voices of Liberty, but there's a lot of people that don't realize that they could sing the music of it. And also, Derric is more than just Voices of Liberty. There's going to be music that we're going to put out that Voices has never sung. And I want everybody to see the breadth of what it is that his work has been, which we won't even be able to touch because there's just so much. But I'm hoping that it just reaches a whole new generation of people because, I mean, you've been doing this for a long time and it's affected a lot of people. So why stop now? I mean, it doesn't need to stop anytime soon. So that's the hope for what this is to introduce people to what it is. And the nice thing about Derric's music, and this is something that anyone who's ever sung it or stood in that spot at Disney and felt this, it's timeless. It's something that you can sing in 1982 and that you can sing in 2022 and you'll be able to sing in 2052 and it's going to be just as impactful. And I can't say that for every piece of music. So it's nice that is, I feel like that's a big part of his legacy is the timeless component to the music that he's created.
And I heard this 90th birthday, by the way, happy birthday from all of us here at J.W. Pepper.
Thank you, Jennifer.
It was quite the party.
It was a big one. It was great.
It was just a few hundred people showed up. Yeah. That's all. People flew in from all over the country.
Yeah, 10 states is amazing.
It was great. It was, and everybody there who had ever sung with Derric got up and sang his happy birthday to him, which was a very fun thing to get to do because he's had a happy birthday that every person in that room has sung for years, which is now, shameless plug, published with Excelsia. But interestingly enough, people were like, when I first showed them the happy birthday, I was at TCDA, and they were like, why are we publishing a happy birthday? What is a happy birthday? What is that? And I explained it to them and talked about, well, there's not a lot of happy birthdays that are published. First of all, it wasn't public domain until, I don't know, within the last decade. So it's a very specialized happy birthday. And what's great about it is every single person who's ever been in Voices of Liberty can sing it. I've taken it to I have a student group at the college that I teach at. Every single person who's been in that knows it. And so what's nice is that anywhere you go, You can sing a happy birthday for someone at the schools, an administrator, a teacher, a student, a visitor, anybody. We go around the building and we'll sing, and it makes their day. Because it's not just like a restaurant staff coming up and singing happy birthday to you. It's a, there's some lush, beautiful chords, but it's not, that's not what the whole thing is about. So it's, that's a fun one for sure. And I mean, I'll be honest, and Voctave has been asking for a happy birthday for 7 years, and because of Derric's, I just can't even think of anything. It's just so good. Honestly, we don't have a happy birthday because Derric's was just so good that I'm stumped in trying to come up with anything that we could do.
That is so amazing. And Derric, we're so thankful for all the things that you've really created over these years. And it's so neat that you are like a pioneer, an innovator in all of these styles of music. And I mean, who knew how popular a cappella music was going to become, you know, with all the advent of these other super groups, you know, and everybody being into it and, you know, wanting to emulate that sound and create that. And I think its influence on the classical choral world. There are so many concert works now that have that sort of contemporary a cappella influence while still being, you know, properly in the genre of concert music. And just think you were a real front runner there.
Well, thank you, Jen.
I mean, it's amazing to look back and see what was going on when he started it and how there weren't 50 other a cappella groups that are out there. And I mean, that's something that I'm thankful with Voctave. We've got other a cappella groups that are different, some that are similar, and we can celebrate each other. But what was nice is they were pioneers. I mean, the fact that there were people in the industry telling him, nobody wants to hear a cappella music.
That's right.
Who cares about singers? I mean, that's not said now, so that's a benefit that we've got for sure. But we're able to stand taller because of the work that he did.
And thank you from all of us here. And I can't wait to see what new arrangements are going to be coming year after year in the Derric Johnson series. It's going to be so fun to discover them along with the general public and all of our choirs out there who will be, I'm sure, eagerly looking forward to see what those are.
Thank you so much.
Me
great
too.
To meet you and be with you.
Jamey, let's shift over a little bit to Voctave and maybe how it was spawned and, you know, how it built on the shoulders of Voices of Liberty and all that good stuff.
So Voctave kind of came out of, I don't want to say accident, but it was not planned. And I was doing different projects and different recordings with all people from Voices of Liberty. When Voices of Liberty is not at Disney, they go by a very clever name of the Liberty Voices, so as not to step on Disney's toes. But I was doing things with a lot of singers and living in that world, and started doing some videos and recordings that people were starting to notice. And what really happened was the girl from Pentatonix, Kirsten Maldonado, who is one of the sweetest and most wonderful friends of mine now, she saw a video of a group singing something that I had written of the Disney Fly Medley. And reached out, and we talked about doing something together, and her boyfriend at the time came and sang with her, and when he got to me, he said, okay, so what is this group of singers? Who are these people? What are you doing? And I was like, well, I mean, they're friends. We've sung together at Disney, and we're just kind of doing some things for fun that we like. And he goes, enough of that. You need a name. You need a set group. You need a website. You need other things. And I thought, okay, I don't want to come up with a name and all this, because he said, as soon as we post this video with Kirsten, people are going to go and look for this group. And if you don't exist, then you don't exist. And so I thought, okay, great. And I mean, there's a story behind the name, but I wanted, at that point, I had 8 singers in the group plus myself. And so I, with just like Derric, with high notes and low notes, I liked the idea of 8 VA. And then I said that to Jeremy, and he said, that's terrible. It's a terrible name. Don't do that. And I was like, why? What's wrong with it? And he goes, and I said, it's because the 8 VA is the octave above and octave below. And he goes, well, go to trademark 8 VA.
Yeah.
And I was like, okay, I guess I can't do that. And he was like, go buy 8va.com. You can't. He was like, pentatonic is a word. Pentatonics with an X is not a word. So he was like, what does 8 VA mean? And I was like, it means an octave. And he goes, stop. You're a vocal group. Put a V in front of it. It's Voctave. And at first I was like, I hate that. That doesn't, he's like, eventually it'll just be a word. And man, was he right. But what's interesting now is people ask us where the name came from. And while that's a long and involved story, what's more fun to say now is that the highest note that we've recorded and the lowest note we've recorded is 5 octaves away from each other. So V kind of acts as our Roman numeral 5, and it's 5 octaves. So that's a more fun story to tell, but that wasn't the initial reason behind it. But So after that, we just thought we'd be a recording group. And we had session singer kind of feel with the group and put out a Christmas album first. I guess we had a digital album first that wasn't physically released, but then we did a Christmas album. And people just were asking for concerts and live concerts. And so I thought, okay, I guess we'll try this live thing. And at that point, I had been writing more notes than people because we were just in the studio. So I added an alto and I added a bass. And then that's where we've been ever since. And it was not a planned thing. And everything along the way it's worked itself out beautifully with the different guest artists that we've got. I mean, Tiffany Coburn, being in the gospel music world as long as she had, she picked up the phone and called Sandy Patty and asked Sandy Patty to sing with us, and picked up the phone and called Mark Lowry, and Mark Lowry sang Mary Did You Know with us. I mean, I don't know that you're going to get a better experience than getting to sing Mary Did You Know with the man who wrote Mary Did You Know. And he was, first of all, hilarious, but one of the most gracious and lovely people that we've gotten to work with. Actually, all of the artists that we've worked with have been that. And so it's been nice to have that. But like I said earlier, what's nice is that when we come together to rehearse, I don't have to talk to them about a sound. The sound exists because of something that Derric created. And but one benefit that I do have, at least for right now, is when I'm writing a part for someone, I'm writing it for that exact person, not just for a soprano that's going to sing it one day or an alto that might sing it. I'm writing that line for that exact specific person, and they are able to take ownership over that line, and they're able to turn it into as much musically as they can. And that's where I think a lot of our arrangements have taken shape, is the ownership over these lines, and that I've made sure that it celebrates that person. And that's been kind of fun to watch that evolution, because when they first started, that wasn't the plan. But now it's very much, I wrote that alto suspension for Sarah to sing, and because I knew exactly how she would sing it. And it's nice to have, I mean, these, I hate to use the term, but these freaks that have come in, and I mean, they came because of him. And so I'm getting to benefit from that. But what's nice is that when we go out places and we tour, one of the first questions all the time that people will come up and say to us is, have you ever heard of Regeneration? Do you know the group Regeneration? And what was nice for us is there was a concert that we did in, I want to say it was in Arizona, I don't remember where we were. And Derric's very first soprano, Susie, came to our show. And it was exciting for us because it's someone who I had met. I mean, she was singing first soprano, and I mean, this is someone who had a C above high C. I mean, she was an unusual person vocally. And so she came to the concert, and it was nice to be able to, I acknowledged in the audience, I said, you know, we're all here tonight. We're so glad to be here tonight, but there is somebody here who helped pave the way. And I said, you all, after I introduced Kate, our first soprano, I said, this is someone who does things that most people can't even dream of. But the reason she gets to do it is because of this first soprano that's here tonight. And I mentioned Susie, which was, it was an honor for us to just be able to say, this is the heritage that we've got. And we talk about, I mean, Kevin Miles was on the very first recording that I ever did of any of my arrangements. On the very first night that I did a recording, it was my Star Spangled Banner and my All Is Well. And it was Kevin who, at the end of the song, I had written a low B because I knew Kevin Miles was coming in, but there was the A above it, and he had to drop the A down to the B. And he goes, you know, it's a seventh drop. He goes, that's going to be tough to land on that. He goes, why don't I just come from the A below it? And I said, I mean, okay. So he recorded that, and he sang the A and the B. And for a long time, it was just, it's definitely an optional low A and B. But the basses that can sing that love looking at that and saying, hey, there's notes written for me to sing. But again, Kevin is one of the people who helped pave the way for these basses that get to actually sing really, really low notes. And we have it's funny because we in our show we do anything you could do, I could do better. And it's a contest of high notes and low notes and long notes. And it's always funny to watch the audience react to the high note, because it's actually between our tenor and our soprano. Obviously, our soprano will always win, but our tenor ends up pretty high. But it's interesting to watch that exchange. But the real competition, if you ever see Voctave Live, when they do the long note competition, they really are competing. And whoever finishes last gets to win. And interestingly enough, it's always been the tenor. One day it will be Tiffany. She gets really close in every show, but it's always been the tenor that wins. So, but that's, again, all these people were influenced by these others. And I mean, I was just mentioning to them that we have a concert in a couple of weeks, and we're excited because Derric and Debbie are going to be at the concert. And I was telling Debbie that she stood on the floor at Voices of Liberty with all three altos in our group, and they think of her as someone who has helped mold them into the people that they are, the singers that they are, the performers that they are. And so to have that connection from that group that they learned sitting in a rehearsal at Disney next to someone who has kind of shown them the way, to get to be able to celebrate that years later in front of her in the audience is exciting and special for them. Just the same way that I feel, while I'm a little nervous, it's nice for me to get to do this in front of Derric and have him hear the things that I've written, trying to do the best that I can to keep up with things that he's done and to celebrate the things that I've learned just by back when I was in college, inputting those notes one at a time into Finale, just to partially to practice Finale, but also to kind of figure out the way that he wrote lines, which is the best thing.
Yeah, Jamey, let's talk a little bit about some of the Voctave Christmas arrangements that you've done.
I mean, I've already mentioned the Mary Did You Know that we did with Mark Lowry, and I mentioned earlier our highest note and lowest note. And interestingly enough, in that arrangement, and I'll give something away, there's a chord that goes to a high G, and in the music it's not written, but there is also a low G in the recording. And that exact chord has all five octaves in it, which is kind of crazy to think about. When Mark came to sing that was exciting for us because he was very excited to sing. I mean, he's sung the song a million times. I mean, more than probably anybody. So it was nice to give him something a little bit different to it. But that's definitely a song that it takes some forces to sing. There's definitely some range to it, and you want to have numbers. But man, I think it's our most viewed Facebook video that exists. And I was not expecting that to happen. Not that I didn't like it, but I want to say now it's got like 35 some million views or around that, which is crazy. And then within the first year, it had about 20. And we had just done another video of another song that I thought was going to take off. It did well, but nothing like that one. I think it helped to definitely have Mark Lowry, but it's definitely a fun arrangement. It's a very haunting arrangement for sure. And I mentioned My All As Well, the one that Kevin added that low A in. So when you go and look at that music and you see that low A and B, the optional ones at the end, you can thank Kevin Miles for that. I wrote that one kind of in a quick hurry. It's the second arrangement I had ever written. I wrote a Star Spangled Banner for my senior recital that got sung by a bunch of my friends in college. And a friend of mine at church, David Wise, as your graduation present, I want to bring some studio singers in and record your Star Spangled Banner. I said, oh, okay, great. Let's do that. And then he started calling different people and booking singers. And he called me, he said, there's good people here. Don't just do one arrangement. If you're going to bring us in, have more than one song ready. It's like, I haven't written anything else. And he goes, well, write something now. So I thought, okay, well, I want to hear Tiffany sing a solo. And so Tiffany was booked on the session. And so I wrote All As Well with a solo at the beginning, which Michael W. Smith's All As Well is one that I've just loved from the very first time I heard it. I love that piece. And so what's funny is we did the recording session. They did both songs. And at the very end, Tiffany had recorded all of the high notes and all of the extra descant obbligato things. And I said, oh, we've got to do the solo at the beginning. She just sung for 4 hours. And she goes, okay, how do you want this to sound? And I said, the way Tiffany Coburn sings. Sing it the way you would sing it. And she looked at it. And we recorded it from beginning to end, the solo in a one take. She goes, okay, so what do you want to do? How do you want me to do this differently? And I said, I don't know what else to tell you. And so that song has now been recorded, I think, four different times. But the solo was only ever recorded once because it was absolutely perfect the first time. And why change that? And so that one is special to me because of that. It's something that I wrote for that exact session, but then when Tiffany sang it, it was the first time I had gotten to hear Tiffany sing something that I had written down. I had listened to her sing everybody else's music, and I loved her voice. And it was my first opportunity to write something down for Tiffany Coburn. I was like, I want to take this opportunity and make it good. And so she, on that recording, it's just absolutely stunning. And that's definitely probably, even though it was the second arrangement I ever wrote, it's probably one of my absolute favorites that I've got. And then some of the other ones, the Christmas ones. A fun one that I've got is A Joy to the World mixed with For Unto Us from Handel's Messiah. And it's probably one of our more fun ones to sing at Christmas time, because a lot of times at Christmas, especially the more sacred pieces, everything can be, I don't want to say a dirge, but it's very serious and very, you got to be very calm with everything. And Joy to the World is just like Derric's. It's fun to sing. And our Joy to the World is very different. But we get to have fun with that one because there's a little fun feature in the middle for the sopranos that are the violins from Handel's Messiah. And so when people hear that in the audience, I always love watching them react to that moment because they're singing the little, the famous violin line that happens in For Unto Us that every musician knows, which is fun to hear. But that's one that we will, if people are like, hey, we want to do something Christmas real quick, just kind of like what he was saying with his Joy to the World, that's one that we can do right now. And we know it, and it's definitely a fun one. Originally, I had written it. It had a different song in the middle. It wasn't Foreign to Us. I want to say it was O Come All Ye Faithful, but I changed that. And now O Come All Ye Faithful is also available. And that one, I have to tell you, if you ever see Voctave live at a Christmas show, O Come All Ye Faithful is the one you might leave talking about, because our tenor soloist, E.J. Cardona, he does things that just like Kate and Susie and Kevin and these people before, most people won't even ever dream of. I mean, they know EJ well, and he does things. And so that ending, the ending is, it's a show-off moment. It's definitely a show moment. It is a show-off what you can do with your tenor. I've had people send me recordings where they were like, we didn't quite have a tenor who could do this, so we did it with one of our altos. Great, fine. It was still awesome to watch. But what's nice is I didn't want that to just be a... some of the hardest things for me when I'm going to write Christmas arrangements is I've loved Derric's version of them for so long that my goal is to just don't sound like his, but I still want to be interesting. So the O Come All Ye Faithful is, I didn't want it to sound like any other. And so I do like that there's a lot of interesting key change moments in there. One of my favorite things to do is to come up with key changes that are going to, that the audience is not predicting. So those are fun in that O Come All Ye Faithful. And I'm trying to think if there's another one in there. Mary, Did You Know? Joy to the World, and O Come All Ye Faithful. I think that might be the Voctave Christmas pieces to look out for. But All Is Well, it's my favorite. I love Mary, Did You Know? But All Is Well. Oh, I guess there's the four. There's the All Is Well is definitely one of my absolute favorites. And I've got a lot of people that will reach out to me because I've had that available for sale for a while. And I've had a lot of different choirs do that. And it's definitely a lovely concert moment. I think that it starts real small, it gets real big in the middle, and then it comes back down real small. And so it's a fun thing to sing again. But yeah, there's different programming for all of these pieces in concerts. I mean, one thing that I've learned from Derric, and I've had to shift it because I didn't start it out with Voctave, because like I said, we were starting out as a studio group. I was just writing pieces that we liked. You got to write pieces that have a function in your show.
That's right.
I mean, you got to have an opener. You got to have a closer. You got to have a moment where the audience gets to enjoy themselves, where they get to laugh, where they get to cry. You want to have all of these moments in there. And so that's what I think is kind of fun about the pieces that I picked for Derric's series at first. I mean, the Away in a Manger is vastly different from French Choral of Praise. And Joy to the World is the most amazing closer that you can have. And so that's how I feel about some of these, that I think that actually our Joy to the World is a fun opener that we've used as an opener before. So having function to all of these things is obviously important as a director. So there's a lot of Christmas options because Christmas music is just so great.
It is great.
It really is. And I know many of our choirs that are customers of J.W. Pepper are out there, hopefully already hard at work on their Christmas arrangements and the things that they're going to be doing for this upcoming holiday season. But if not, there are definitely some new arrangements that we talked about today that they should take a look at and really get moving on quickly.
And then more next year.
That's right. Plan ahead early. If you didn't get some of these this year, then you certainly can get them, you know, for next year. And that would be a great thing, too. Well, it has been our pleasure to host you both for this interview today. And what an honor to speak with both of you. And we're so grateful for what you bring to the industry, what you're bringing to choral groups, and what you're bringing to our JW Pepper customers. We just couldn't be more thrilled. And like I said, we're just looking forward to see what's coming in the future, and we'll be on pins and needles until we get to see that. I almost want to ask for a preview, but I know you won't give it, so.
Well, I can tell you this much. There's a couple of songs that Derric has mentioned in some of his stories that are not out yet. That are definitely on the plan for upcoming years that are some of my favorites. Maybe even that Do You Hear that he mentioned earlier. That's definitely a fun one for any choir that's ever gotten to sing it. So that's exciting for us to get to have some of my favorites in the catalog. And I know that the singers who do the recordings are just excited to sing them. So we'll do it every year.
That'll be exciting. Yes, indeed. We'll be certainly looking forward to it. What great insights from two very awesome composers. If you're interested in any of the music that we went over today, again, we have links in the description of this video, or you can visit jwpepper.com and explore any of the music by Jamey Ray or Derric Johnson. We hope that you found this video helpful. And if there's a composer or arranger that you would like to see us feature, please leave a comment below and let us know. We'd love sharing these interviews and would love to do more of them. If you did find this video helpful, please give us a thumbs up. You can engage us on social media wherever you are, and we even have a 1-800 number if you want to give us a call. And don't forget to subscribe so you don't miss any of the new content we have coming out at JW Pepper.